Welcome to the Jewish Community Center of San Francisco. I'm Jordan Abel, managing producer of the Arts and Ideas series. And I'm so thrilled you are all here for tonight's talk with Nigella Lawson. Tonight's talk is our Lisa and Douglas Goldman Fund lecture, and I want to thank them for this wonderful event. Thank you to the Goldman Fund. There are very few cookbook authors whose first names inspire such delight and recognition. Julia, of course, Ina, yes, Yotam these days, and of course, Nigella. Nigella Lawson is a force of nature. Educated at Oxford, former deputy literary editor of the Sunday Times, she published her first cookbook, How to Eat, at the age of 38. It was a runaway hit and was followed by another 9 books, including her most recent and what we're here to celebrate tonight, Simply Nigella. Her books, dear friends, have sold more than 12 million copies worldwide, which is amazing. Not constrained by the printed word, Nigella is also a television personality who hosted The Taste here in the US and several programs in England. And like all good San Franciscans, she's also a tech entrepreneur as well. She has a groundbreaking quick collection apps. So please join me to welcome Nigella Lawson.
Thank you. It's a lovely introduction. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you so much for coming. We're thrilled to have you.
I'm thrilled to be here.
And welcome to San Francisco. What time did you arrive here today?
About an hour before I got here. I just had time to unpack some clothes, get out my little travel steamer, fill it up with water, steam what I'm wearing. As you can see, I didn't have time to do my hair properly. But it was either crumpled clothes or hair, and I just felt my hair was a battle I was never going to win.
Well, I think your hair, I think it looks wonderful to you. We think, yeah, it's good hair. And have you spent much time in San Francisco?
I have before? Over the years. I love it. I love San Francisco. I have a rather foolish smile on my face as I drive into San Francisco from the airport. It's a very vibrant place with such an exciting food culture, but also such a wonderful book culture. So for me, I feel very, very at home and always excited to see the new place I'm going to eat at, always thrilled to go back to old favorites. But I know I'll forget all the names of them now because I feel like just very happy to be here.
Great. Well, we're thrilled to have you. And of course, we will talk a lot about your wonderful new book. But I thought we might start by learning a little bit more about you, if that's
all
right.
Yeah, of course.
Okay, so I wanted to start by talking a little bit about your early years and your career path. So I know that you started, you grew up in London and you were the child of a prominent politician, your father. And
well, yes, although when I was a child, he was a journalist. He became a politician later. I was 14 then. So in a way, it was I grew up among journalists, and that's probably one of the reasons why I went into journalism. I like the conversation of journalism. It doesn't quite exist like that anymore. But
so when you were small, did you always sort of think, well, I'll be a journalist because that's what... Your family?
No, I didn't really. I didn't know what I wanted to do. I did at one stage, I think I wanted to be a writer. I was terribly embarrassed in things. I wrote, when I was about 9, I wrote a play about life and as two terrapins talking about the meaning of life. I attempted a novel. I've got some sort of school book that I did. I mean, when I say school, but I mean, you know, 10 or something.
Okay.
And I read compulsively. But I don't know that I ever thought, you know, what am I going to do mm-hmm. when I grow up? I didn't think. But then I'm still not someone who makes plans. I certainly didn't think I would do what I have ended up doing. That was not on the cards.
Okay. And were you someone who was always cooking with your... parents?
Well, yes, but that's my mother believed in child labor. And really, I mean, it's so that she didn't teach us to cook, or she didn't do it as people do now as a way of something that would entertain their children. She just needed, you know, the work done. And so, you know, There were four of us all told, but I had a sister who was 16 months younger than me, and she'd put us both on rickety chairs by a gas range, and we'd be stirring. I mean, you wouldn't be allowed to do that sort of thing now, but, you know, stirring things. We'd have to make mayonnaise. One of us would have the bowl with the egg yolks, and the other would be and be whisking, and then one person would be pouring. I always preferred to be whisking because it was. I was always so frightening that you'd pour too much, and my mother would be cross. You know, so you'd have to go slowly, but. And whisk fast, and you never whisk quite fast enough. So it was quite a baptism by fire. But it was, I value it now because I think you grow up with certain instincts about what cooking is, and it stood me in good stead later.
That's wonderful. And your
but I didn't like eating. I should hasten to add, I hated eating as a child. And when people come to me at book signings and say, it's very hard for me to get my kids to eat, I would say, it'll sort itself out.
So what was your favorite thing to eat when you were small?
It's getting to sound odd, but I really liked spinach. But I didn't, okay. I really liked spinach.
I think a lot of parents would be pleased if their children were only eating.
My grandmother was, always used to tell a story about when I was quite young, and I was very close to my maternal grandmother, and it was a heat wave in England, and it was a sweltering day in July, and we went to take some respite from the heat into a cafe, and she said, and what would you like to eat? And I said, I'd like some steam buttered spinach and some hot chocolate. You know, it's like 104 degrees out. But I think what I really liked was the element of choice, that you could say, this is what I would like. And I think when I was a child, it's not like it is now when children. I always say to people that when I was a child, I grew up in a totalitarian state run by parents. And then when I had children, I lived in a totalitarian state ruled by children. I somehow have missed the window of opportunity. But actually, I'm not good at authority, so that's probably just as well. But certainly, children didn't have much choice in what they ate or so forth. And I think that I enjoyed eating and I enjoyed cooking much more when an element of choice and my own desires played some part in it. And certainly, when I was at university, I cooked a lot.
So you went to Oxford,
mm-hmm.
And what did you study at Oxford?
Well, officially, it's called Medieval and Modern Languages.
Mm-hmm. And unofficially?
We just languages. I mean, okay, you know what I mean? Okay. But it's like you don't sit there doing. I mean, because in the olden days, which is when this was, you had to sit an exam if you wanted to go to Oxford or Cambridge. And I sat it in French and German, but I said I didn't really. I had done enough French, I felt, and I wanted to learn something new. And Oxford was very snobbish about the Latin languages, because they thought if you'd done French and Latin, which I had, you didn't need to know anything to be able to do Italian. So I said, which to some extent is true. I mean, you can read quite a lot if you have a grounding there. But I promised I would go off to Italy and, you know, study. I didn't. I went to Italy, but I didn't study. But I did learn Italian.
So
I did that. So I because of that, and if you're doing Italian, you do have to start at the very earliest beginnings, and Italian doesn't really exist till quite recently. But certainly, so you start from Latin, then Provençal, and so you have to learn all sorts of strange things.
We don't really teach languages that way here in the States. So you speak.
We're not. I read more than I can speak.
Okay.
I mean, but I'm not. My basic languages are French, German, and English. I can understand a certain amount of Portuguese or Spanish if it's written, and I find it quite hard to understand spoken. But sometimes I can have a conversation in Spain if I speak Italian. But it's harder because the root of the words is so easy to understand when you see it printed, but not as much when people talk. But I think most of my languages are pretty rusty by now.
Okay.
I'm rather fearing that English is going to be quite rusty soon.
I don't think we're in danger of that.
I was going, funnily enough, yeah. I was going to read English literature, uh-huh. and I got what was called an unconditional, which is however you do in your exams at school, you can come here at Oxford. And I suddenly thought, I don't want to talk to strangers about books I love. And so I said, no, my father was really thought I'd gone absolutely mad when I said I didn't want that. But I did want to do something else. I think I enjoy making things a bit hard on myself. So rather than go in and what I was given a place for, rather take an exam, and then having taken an exam, wanting to give up what I had learned for so long and, you know, start something new.
So languages at Oxford. You went to Italy to study. But didn't study.
No, I went to Italy and I ended up working as a chambermaid in a pensione. Mm-hmm.
Are there any anecdotes?
Well,
from that?
All I can tell you is, I'm sure this doesn't happen in the good hotels, but all I can tell you is we did try on people's clothes. And we did, if you saw a lovely bottle of scent, which we what we call perfume in England, so if you saw a nice bottle of scent, you might spritz a bit on. But it was really awful. I will say, I said, when I went to Italy, I went with a school friend, and I said, I'll do absolutely anything except for clean lavatories, and I ended up cleaning lavatories. But it was also rather wonderful because it was a family-run pensione, and there was a grandmother of the house, the nonna, who really was from central casting, and although we weren't, me and my friend Emily, we weren't really allowed in their family kitchen, when the people who owned it, Ugo and Gabriele, when they weren't there, she got a bit lonely. So she'd always say, come into the kitchen. So I learned an awful lot by watching her cook and sometimes helping her as well. And also I learned how to gossip in Italian, because she always wanted to talk about, you know, everyone in each room. And it was very, very good. But though when I had started at Oxford, we once had to go around and we had to translate some George Bernard Shaw. You call him Bernard Shaw, Dave. You know who I mean. And we had to go around the class and we had to translate him into Italian. And I did a bit, and the professor there said to me, that's fine, Nigella, but I just don't think he would have sounded like a Florentine greengrocer. Because, of course, I'd learnt Italian that way. And so, of course, I was thrilled I sounded like a Florentine greengrocer. Now I think I probably just sound like an English tourist, but there you go.
And then after Oxford, you were a journalist.
First, I was a publisher. I went into publishing because I love books, and I thought, I want to go into publishing. And I went into publishing, but I also did some book reviewing mm-hmm. in the evenings where I could get work. I did mostly for some TLS, Times Literary Supplement.
And you became the deputy literary editor.
But not until not until the advanced age of 26.
Well,
I'm still a bit younger.
Yes, very advanced.
I worked first on the arts pages mm-hmm. of the Sunday Times, and I that was quite interesting. But it was very old school in those days, so it was quite a good training, actually.
And as literary critic, are there any books that you review that stand out even to this day in the?
Well, yes, but although funnily enough, I didn't review. I'm so much when you're a young reviewer, you're generally given like that used to be called like the not particularly illustrious fiction roundup. It doesn't exist so much now because there's not space, sadly. So because much more coverage could be given to books in those days. Although still the editor would always fight it because he could never understand why. So it was sometimes you just have five novels and they didn't really go together at all and you had to do them in 1,000 words. I did a lot of paperback roundups. I did anything I could. I'm trying to think if I reviewed. I mean, I did review things, but it was often more interviews. I mean, I interviewed Arthur Miller, and that was very interesting. He was so wise, and I really felt like I wanted to ask him questions about everything. I wanted to say, and what brand? I was just moving into a flat, my first flat, and what brand of washing machine should I get? And I felt like he had the answer to everything, and actually we made friends because I felt my stepfather was a very illustrious philosopher. I don't know if any philosophers amongst you, but he was A.J. Ayer, Freddie Ayer. And so I knew that when he went away, that everyone else would go out and he'd always be left alone because people thought he was too grand to be included. And so I said to Arthur Miller, knowing that he was... And I said to him, what are you doing? You know, what are you doing in the evening or something? And he said, well, everyone... He had a play on at the Old Vic. And he said, well, everyone's going out and they never invite me. And I said, well, do you want to go out for supper? And we made friends and it was nice. And then I drove him to the airport when he went back because in those, you know, he didn't have a retinue and people, you know, publishing, he was a lovely man. And I had a very beaten up old car and it was like a mobile library. It had so many books in it and he just couldn't believe it. But also I asked him to sign a book to me. It made me laugh. It's that I did a very odd mixture. I always feel slightly responsible for the dumbing down of the British press because I suggested before that I did an interview with Barry Manilow, which they never would have done in the arts pages in those days. But I said, you know, why not? But anyway, so then I asked Arthur Miller to sign a copy of his collected works for me. And I promise you, I looked at it afterwards. I thought he was going to say this, I read literary. And it was really, I said to him, I may as well have got Barry Manilow to sign it because it said, to Nigella, a spark in the dark.
Oh.
So I'm like, what, Arthur? But anyway, Artie, what are you doing? But it was, you know, I liked that. But I gave up interviewing, really, because I felt they started wanting... Even then, they said, oh, you haven't asked him about Marilyn Monroe. And I said, I don't want to ask him about Marilyn Monroe. Do you know? I want to ask him about his writing. And obviously, and the washing machine and everything, but that was private. But I did also feel that at that stage, there began to be this element of... You were meant to say something snide or disobliging, which I don't like. And I felt if someone was really interesting like him, really, I'd rather just put his words down. And if they weren't interesting, I didn't really want to be interviewing them. So I moved away from that side of the business.
And when we had Yotam Ottolenghi here, we were talking about how for him, a career in the kitchen wasn't at all what his family was expecting. It wasn't necessarily what he was expecting. So I'm just curious about your family and your sort of shift away from this journalistic tradition into food writing.
I feel though it's less of a shift for me than it is for Yotam, because Yotam has got a life in the kitchen in the sense he owns restaurants and he runs a test kitchen and that sort of thing. Whereas for me, it isn't at all what I expected, but I have always cooked. And when I write about food, I feel I'm still very aware of the language that I'm using, and it's very important to me that the language gets as close as at all possible to explaining not just what the food may taste like, the texture. It's quite hard with language, really, because they are very different domains, and it was the challenge of how do I use language, which is in itself abstract, to conjure up a world which belongs in the realm of the senses. It was that challenge that first made me want to write about food. So I feel that at all times that is still uppermost in my mind, but I also think that an inquiry into how we eat and what we're eating is also to some extent an exploration into what it is to be human and it's the history of us as people, how we connect with one another, how the language of our own families, of our own backgrounds, of the age in which we live. All, so to me, I feel there is a journalistic element, but there is also it sounds pretentious, but a kind of writerly element that makes me feel that it's not, that I haven't actually moved so drastically away. Now, I'm not writing the great novel of the 21st century, and I don't have any particular literary claims for what I do, but I'm very engaged by what I do. So I feel that journalism has changed. I'm probably very lucky I jumped ship.
Yes. And your writing in all of your books is really beautiful, and I just you pack so much in, and it's a recipe for beats, which I'm gonna, you know, and there's references to Shakespeare and rap songs, and I think you might be the only cookbook writer who's managed to now, in I think two of your books, talk about Nazism and Puritanism, because you quote how to eat in the new... So I'm just wondering if you could read this highlighted section from the introduction.
Okay. In How to Eat, written so long ago, I wrote, "What I hate is the New Age voodoo about eating. The notion that foods are either harmful or healing, that a good diet makes a good person, and that that person is necessarily lean, limber, toned and fit. Such a view seems to me in danger of fusing Nazism with its ideological cult of physical perfection and Puritanism with its horror of the flesh and belief in salvation through denial." Do you want me to carry on?
So you wrote that in your first cookery book, How to Eat. And when you presented your manuscript to your publisher, I mean, were they... Did you have carte blanche in terms of what you were going to put in there? Because I don't think that... I can't think of an American cookbook author with their first book sort of having
Yes, I suppose that it wasn't quite just a regular cookbook. For a start, it was published, and I feel a great honour, and published by Chateau and Windus. Chateau and Windus were the publishers set up by Virginia and Leonard Wolfe. And they published Proust in English, and there's a... It was a small literary imprint. And it still remains largely that way. I mean, obviously now it's part of some huge media conglomerate, but, you know, many things are. But it is that sort of a publishing house, and it's run by really great, engaged and literate and involved editors, and I'm very grateful to be there. So... Quite apart from the fact that although How to Eat runs at almost 500 pages, actually, I had to cut half of it. I'd written so much. But there aren't illustrations. The recipes sometimes are printed as recipes. Sometimes they're within the narrative. Sometimes there's notes. I don't know what I thought I was writing when I was writing it. I didn't really think it would be a cookbook. The fact that more recipes came in surprised me. But I was really let to do my own thing. And the only, so no one minds. I'm not interfered with, except for the fact that what says everything about my fabulous publishers is that they were quite happy with the reference to Macbeth in my beet pickle recipe, but what they couldn't get their heads around was the wrap. They didn't know what that was. I have to leave some treats. So okay. I love that. So they didn't
You're
mind that at
treat.
All. But so I feel I'm allowed to have my own voice, and I thought I'd only write one book, but I did feel I found my own voice, and it's lovely to be encouraged in that by my publishers, but also by my readers. And I sometimes, not with my publisher now, and who I've gone back to, a wonderful publisher, Will Shorby, and Bob Miller, who were my publishers ages ago at Hyperion, but and they're great, and they're absolutely fine, but sometimes I have been questioned about certain things, and I always say, look, my readers aren't stupid. They understand, you know, there is a suggestion. I think this comes, I'm afraid, from an older age when people thought that one, they thought cookbooks for women. Two, they thought that women, if they were interested in cooking or something like that, couldn't be interested in literature or politics or the arts. And so they thought, well, we know that's not true. We are as human beings, we're interested in many different things. And I think it's, you know, like Yotam, you know, had a doctorate or was doing a master's in philosophy. I do what I do. We all carry on reading things. And even if you haven't been educated like that, we're alive, we're in the world, we can be interested in many different things. And actually, when I read a book about food, I like to feel that I'm being held by a particular intelligence or that it's an authentic voice. And I learn something more than how many eggs I put in that recipe. I want to learn a bit about why that recipe is chosen, what it means to the author, and where it fits into her life or his life, or how it could fit into mine. And I think that the story behind a recipe is essential. Otherwise, really just go on to the internet. And then you can get as many recipes as you like. But the thing is, it's about relationship. Everything in the world that matters is about rapport and relationship. And it interests me as well, as someone who went into literary journalism 100 years ago, and people were talking about the death of the book then, that now a food blogger can have a gazillion hits online, but he or she will still want to publish a book, and a book is still important. And the death of the book has been proclaimed so often, but the book endures because we are human and we have an appetite for narrative and an appetite for relationship.
That's wonderful. Thank you. One of the things I
bit of my hobby horse there, you might have noticed.
I love about your books and your recipes is that it really does feel like you're right there in the kitchen with us. And I love the way, you know, I was making the warm cauliflower salad this weekend, and you're very clear about giving us every bit of information we need. Like, don't rinse that bowl out. You're going to use it again to toss the next thing, but not too much information. And it just feels like you're right there. And it's wonderful, and it's so thrilling to read a recipe for radicchio, where you call the radicchio in its Episcopalian splendor. And there's just some of the words I think you make up, maybe. And
some of the words I do.
But they're also...
Verdi glorious.
Yes.
Is a favorite of mine. We can only see that's from language, Verdi, you know, from green. And sometimes when you have a salad in front of you, or you could be making pesto, I don't know. It's, yeah. But you know, the thing is, being a home cook and means that I don't have some of, well, I know what I'm doing, though, and as do all home cooks, but nevertheless, I don't know about technique particularly, so it means that when I write a recipe, I myself might think, oh, that doesn't look ready. So if I, for example, I've got a recipe for honey pie. It's an adaptation of a wonderful one from the Brooklyn 420 Blackbirds, but much simpler. Not that there's as complex, I mean, it's mine has a dough that you press in, you don't have to roll out. But when I do it and I say, at 30 minutes, you might need 35 minutes, but at 30 minutes, you'll think I've made a mistake and it's not cooked, but the next 10 minutes or whatever, everything will change. And I know that, but that's because also I've cooked it, and I too was worried when I thought, this is not going to cook, but it did. And so I try again and I do it, and I think that, everything is tested in a domestic oven. It's not, I haven't started off with a huge recipe, and then, because the professional ovens are so much hotter than anything we cook at or cook in at home. So I suppose in that sense, I have some of the worries. I have the same worries as my readers. And so I identified them. And I just really voice my thoughts about the recipe as I write. It's a bit of a stream of consciousness. Sometimes that has to be curtailed. I can see by the look of panic in your eyes, you're understanding.
No. So your process, just using the new book as an example, Simply Nigella, can you tell us a bit about how the idea came to you for this book and what you thought about including? And then I'm also curious about a deep dive into maybe how you develop one recipe.
Okay, well, that's...
Start.
Okay,
that was a lot.
I'm going to try and do it briefly. You know, I don't talk briefly. Okay, so I... Normally, in the normal run of things, I would have done a book 2 years after my last one, and I didn't really feel... I was ready to do that, and I'd been cooking quite a bit in a rented kitchen, and it was quite interesting because, you know, I didn't have a lot of my stuff with me, and I felt I was cooking in a different way, not emphatically different. I've always cooked quite simply, you know, not having the dexterity to do otherwise, or the patience, frankly. And I've got a fantastic publisher, Gail Rebuck, who sort of runs the show in Britain and a lot of Europe. And we were discussing it, and what I was cooking and how I felt about food. And actually, I've always done my own titles. Well, no, but she suggested the title, and I said, I don't know. And she said, no, because that's what it sounds like, just like your food, and it's simple and it's pared back. And I thought, no, that does make sense. It gave me a lot of leeway as well. So for me, I don't really think in just in terms of the title. I think I start seeing the framework of a book in my head and the structure, and I think of the chapters. And really, each chapter could be a book on its own, and there were times when my editor thought they were in danger of becoming so, as it got bigger and bigger. So, for example, one chapter about everyday cooking is called Quick and Calm, because like a lot of people, I don't have a lot of time every day for cooking. But for me, fast can sometimes be frenetic, and that doesn't help me, because the whole book's subtitle is Feel Good Food, and for me, that means food that makes me feel good when I'm cooking it just as much as when I'm eating it. So Quick and Calm was sometimes, like the salad you mentioned, which I think is bowl food, but that is the same, which is actually you put it in the oven. So you're not stirring things and trying to get things into one pan or having two pans on the stove. It's just ways in which you can get supper on the table and also have a bit of a decompression period as well. And bowl food, well, I think it almost speaks for itself. You know, that it sometimes I just like food that is the same from one spoonful to the next and a forkful. Soups, noodles, pastas. The fact that it rhymes with soul food is no accident, I feel. And I've got another chapter called Breathe, and this came to me quite importantly, which is either crock pot or cooking or is food that you cook in a low oven that you might do in advance so that later on in the week you've got everything set aside. And I felt that was very important, that sense of buying yourself breathing space. And at the same time, maybe it's some and I would say I've had this, my atavistic refugee mentality, which is that I always rest a little easier if I've got a lot of food in the house. I have to have meals in the future, I can relax. So that's how I do it, like that. I feel my way, but I never quite know. In the same way, when I was an op-ed columnist, which I forgot to mention in my career things, when I wrote an op-ed column and I used to have to speak to the editor about what I was going to write about, I always used to say, do I have to tell you? Because then where will I find the interest to write it? And I think there is that sense, really, I write a book to find out exactly what I'm thinking.
So...
And as opposed to as a recipe, for example, I have many different ways. So I might be cooking myself supper and I think, oh, that was really good. And I might jot down what I did afterwards, not weights and measures, because it'll just be what I did. And then I'll do it again. I have one person who worked with me for years. She's not full time, but she was meant to be 2 weeks or a month about 10 years ago, 13 years ago. And she stayed on. But so then I will cook it again. And as I'm doing it, she'll write down what I'm doing. So, because it's very hard to write and cook, because it stops your creativity. You've got to be stirring and feeling. And so I do it that way. And sometimes, otherwise, I might read a recipe and think I want to fiddle about with it and change it. And I always, if a recipe comes via someone else, I always credit it, you know, and you see in the introduction, one of the great things about being a home cook also, I'm not obliged to be novel. So if another writer or if a food blogger or if a friend has given me an idea for a recipe, I like to credit that. And I also feel the evolution of a recipe is interesting. I notice often when I see my recipes crop up with other writers, they don't always feel the same way. But I do think, and in fact, I have a recurring nightmare, which is that I have used someone's recipe and not credited him or her because I've somehow not known I've done that. Because recipes aren't, it's not about originality, it's about how you develop an idea and where you got it from is really interesting. I mean, there's one thing there, for example, I've got something that is a fusion there of Yotam's mother's mayonnaise which is really fascinating, uses a whole egg rather than just yolks.
And so your mother's mayonnaise.
Yotam's mother's mayonnaise.
Right, right, right. No, I know, but the difference between...
No, very different. My mother my mother would be turning in her grave, I'm afraid, at Yotam's mother's mayonnaise. and that I made it. And also with something I ate in some restaurant in Brooklyn or somewhere in New York. You get ideas and they fuse together, and I like that. I always like it, actually. The wonderful thing is that Yotam really does bring a jar of his mother's mayonnaise when he comes for dinner, which is very, is so not, it's made with whole eggs. It's done in a processor. My mother insisted only by hand. It's done in a processor and it's got garlic, a teeny bit of sugar, and lots of cilantro in it. And it's really, I think it's in one of his books, but I just know he just bought it once and I made him give me the recipe. And it's just in my thing as Yotam's mother's mayonnaise.
And will you tell us what you then do with that mayonnaise in the...
So what I did, I had, when I was somewhere, I can't remember exactly where I was, I had a steak with a miso mayonnaise, and I liked the idea of the saltiness with the meat, but it was really rich mayonnaise. It wasn't at all right. So I thought, what happens if I make Yotam's mother's mayonnaise, not put quite as much garlic as she did, and maybe slightly more acidic and add the miso? So I did. So that's how, so in a way, you get an idea, but it's not a question of just, oh, I'll change one ingredient. It's much more, as I cook it, I develop, you know, I just felt her mayonnaise, Jonathan's mother's mayonnaise, would be a very good basis for the miso, and better, because miso is quite rich, and mm-hmm. with the egg yolk, it seemed too much mm-hmm. for me.
And then what do you do with the miso mayonnaise once you're...
Well, I like it. I've got some chicken drumsticks, which I have with a sake marinade, and I thought, well, I'll try them with that, since it's roughly in the same register. So that I do, but I also just like it with crudité, you know, something like very clean and crunchy like fennel. That's wonderful, sort of herbal anise. I love that. Is it me making all that crackling noise? If it is me, I apologize. I do that, but also I like it. There's another sauce there that this is only for people who really like their food fiery, which, you know, you start making something and then you find you can't stop eating it with everything.
Is it the chili?
It's the chili, yeah, garlic and ginger.
That's very good.
Which was, yes, which is also quite similar to the basis of a curry that a Malaysian friend taught me. And it's quite funny, when I was testing out the curry and I put a picture on Instagram, every person who follows me on Instagram who's Malaysian said, because I said when I was cooking, you haven't put enough chilies, because they could tell by the colour. I love that. They say, you haven't put enough chilies. I said, I know, I'm just testing, but it's quite helpful.
Yeah.
So, and if something doesn't go right, I will say, you know. And so when I'm testing a recipe, if it doesn't work by the third time, that's out, I have a three strikes and you're out rule. Because I feel that if you have to labour at a recipe, it's not meant to be.
And how long does the process take from when you sort of start really working on the recipes? And
it so depends. It so depends. I spend so long not writing it that almost projects me very fast.
Because of procrastination?
Yes.
Or okay.
but yes, and actually, I've got a very good term that I someone who follows me on Twitter, who's Australian, called Aya Raina, I think coined, called procrastinate baking, which I have in there, which is when I feel like when I ought to be writing, I suddenly make up a new recipe for cookies or something. I really did this book late. I mean, I really jumped on the train as it was leaving the platform. There are a load of publishers' bodies littered in London and New York. Who I really have worn into the ground, and I apologize. I would say that, given that it was published in October in the UK, they actually didn't have their hands on a finished manuscript till June.
Wow.
I mean, I give it chapter by chapter, but it was late. It was late, but I knew it could. I knew they had enough time within the schedule. I knew they could do it. Mm-hmm. It was harder for America, but I knew they could do it. And when I don't know whether I should own up when I started writing and working on it, because that would be a I don't know if I can do that. It might get me into too much trouble.
Okay.
But all I will say is I spent the best part of a year putting it off, and in every way.
But while you were maybe putting off writing, but you were cooking.
Yes.
You were cooking every, you know,
it is, but
several
I,
times a week.
But I don't like, yes, but I was cooking before that, and I had the recipes jotted down, but I couldn't get the framework of a book. It just, I had to let it, you know, sort of simmer on the back burner, and you can't rush that. I mean, I can't rush that, because it has to have its own form and shape. So although I had recipes, I couldn't connect the dots. I couldn't see where they fitted. But my late first husband John always used to say, when you're not writing, because he was a journalist as well, when we both put off doing our columns, that when you put it off, you are actually working. Your mind is, in some sense, even if you think you're, you know, doing all the washing the dishes, and you are washing the dishes, and you're doing everything you normally would put off doing. Actually, I quite like washing the dishes. Anything to do with ironing, I don't like. But I certainly think that actually that's when things come together. If you try and think, it's a bit like if someone asks you to name a book, and because you're trying to think, you go into a sort of blind spot, and then a few minutes later you have to shout down and say, this is the book I was thinking of. So I feel like that. It's a very important part of the process. And I'm not a churner-outer. Do you know what I mean? I don't feel like it doesn't matter, I can get something done, because you can fill the space, but you really want to feel that you stand by it, and you want to put your name to that, and it matters to me, and I feel that I do have a very important relationship of trust with my readers, and I like to, and I feel that I would never want to betray that, but I just don't think I could do it. It's the same way as that when I'm filming, I can't be scripted, because if I'm given other people's words, it's not that I just don't like it. My brain won't obey, and I just can't remember, and I can't do it. I can only talk extempore. I cannot work in any other way.
And speaking of your work on TV a bit, you're such a writer. We've talked a lot about how important writing is to you and writing the book. So I'm curious about the shift towards, not the shift, but the addition of the TV shows. Do you see those as serving the books?
Yes, or, okay. I do. But I also like the different way of working. And I do think that there's a... My programs, I'm talking about my own ones, you know, are made beautifully like films. And in a way that... people often say here, because it's different, the food programs are made often differently, and also back home, but... You know, how many do you make? One a day, two a day? And I say, no, it's one 30-minute show is a week. We take a week. We light for every shot. It's only one camera. And also, as I say, I'm not scripted. So I am talking in very much the same way as I write. And they're very different. I mean, they're going out in the UK now. And because it's the BBC, you can't access it, but they will come out here, and I just want to make sure when they do, they're not cut down. And
can you tell us what the new shows are about a bit?
It's exactly this, they're based on this, but of course the grammar of television is slightly different from the grammar of a book, so there's more movement in this, but there, the recipes come from there, but I don't know, the director says action, I start talking, and then that's how it goes.
We look forward to seeing them
I hope that, it's a bit difficult because we have the music is different there. But I think that there are certain things television can do better than books. Although I think I've got a fantastic photographer there, and the feeling of light and brightness and that mixture between calmness and serenity, which is a strange combination, but one that I very much wanted to convey. I think we got that in the book, and I think with the television, that as much as I don't really watch it, I saw some of it, you can really get that, and the camera can really help show how something is is cooked.
You can show that, you know, honey, that the pie is in quantity.
Yes, you can do that, and I think that you can, it's really more that thing of the motion, and I think that just like, you know, you said very nicely that it's like having a friend in the kitchen. I think also sometimes that if you can show how simple a recipe is, it always sounds vaguely patronizing when you say it in print or out loud, but when you actually don't say it, but you see through watching, you can see how simple a recipe is, I think it gets people into the kitchen and it gets people interested in food. And I think people also enjoy the language that's used too, because it's very important. People are very emotionally connected to food, and I think that's why every aspect of it matters.
And before we get to all of your questions, which are continuously being handed to me, you speak about being a person of great enthusiasms and that there are kind of some themes that go through your books in terms of ingredients. And I'm just wondering if you can tell us a bit about some of the enthusiasms in Simply Nigella.
Yes, well, I suppose my great deal of enthusiasm for chilies and ginger, fresh ginger. A lot of my enthusiasm is because I love those ingredients, but also that, as I said, being a home cook, so if I buy some fresh ginger, unless I use it in lots of other recipes, it's just going to get withered in my fridge. And I think that I feel always, if I buy an ingredient, it isn't every day or something, then you've got to give other recipes for it, because I need that at home. Yeah. And if I ever buy someone else's book and they send me off to buy something and there's only one recipe using it, I think, well now why have I got that bottle of something in my... I'm going to move on. I rekindled a love I had for cast iron. And I was quite dismissive of cast iron skillets in my first book because I just thought, oh, it's too heavy. And I don't know if I could do it. And then you have to clean them like that. But actually, I really do love, I feel that I like the feeling of having something that sort of feels real in my hands in a way that, and that actually the food tastes so good in it. And so I enjoy that sort of thing. I've even got a slow cooker, a crock pot, where the inner bowl is made out of cast iron, which is fabulous. Those are some of my enthusiasms. Quite a lot of lime, mm-hmm. And smoked salt. And I don't know if any of you have had smoked sea salt. It's really wonderful, isn't it? So I adore salt anyway. I'm very lucky to say I have low blood pressure, so I can have a lot. But also I feel that if you don't eat processed food, you can put as much salt as you want, proper salt, sea salt. But smoked sea salt I came across, and it has this wonderful... fireside or campfire infusion to it, and it's the flavour is so good. And now, it's not to say you have to rush out to the shops and get it, because regular sea salt is also fabulous, but if you have a chance to try it, you must. It's wonderful, and I use it in like a dip that I did for Thanksgiving last year, which is sweet potatoes and caramelised garlic and chickpeas, but I also use it in a salted chocolate tart. It kind of lends itself, and to a salted caramel sauce, it lends itself to pretty much anything you might want to put with it.
And there's a lot of unrefined coconut.
Yes, there's a lot of, there's coconut oil, which I bought a tub of it, right. And because it's about that big, I'm not going to let it go rancid. I'll use it, and I find it excellent in baking. And I find that when I have people for supper, I've got so many people who either gluten-free or dairy-free. Because I like baking, I explored that area of baking quite a bit, and it's very good for dairy-free baking, actually. Although I have to say, I still regard extra virgin olive oil as the elixir of life. I haven't pushed it away.
But there's room for...
There's room for more.
Yes.
I like all fats.
And if you were... We all like all fats, I think.
I also think they're good for you, actually. I'm not being facetious. Obviously, I think some fats aren't good for you, but, the ones that have been invented in a laboratory. But people are finding out all the time, we need certain fats. I feel always it's like moisturizer from the inside. And I feel that balance is so important in a diet. It doesn't mean to say... because I say that doesn't mean to say I want a stick of butter in everything I eat. Although I read the other day, and this is a family history, that 4 tablespoonfuls of extra virgin olive oil a day seems to have a significant effect on breast cancer. So since I have that in my family, I'm now glugging away. I go around like this.
And I do want to touch a little bit on that idea of comfort and food as comfort and sort of traditional comfort food and what we can ask food to give us. And you talk about it beautifully in the book.
Comfort food is a difficult term because, as I say in the book, I think more often than not it's a misnomer, and actually it's discomfort food, and it doesn't make you feel good when you eat it. I don't want, by comfort food for me, I don't use food as emotional ballast, I have to say, and that's because I don't deprive myself of food, so I don't feel it needs to fill a space, because it's always there, and I know there's the next meal, and I eat what I want to eat, which is a wonderful way of stopping one going into those ups and downs. But nevertheless, I find cooking itself and the knowledge that I'm sustaining myself in a real force, and it makes me feel stronger in itself. And I always say that, you know, we know that cooking for other people is an act of kindness or generosity, but we should never underestimate how important it is to extend that kindness and generosity to ourselves. And I think for me that you could say is comfort food. It's not like drowning your sorrows in the kitchen. It's much more about reaffirming one's sense of self, feeling strong, feeling grounded, and I think exploring what one's own tastes are and how one responds to certain flavors in the knowledge that you're being creative, but you're also doing something quite prosaic as well, that is just sort of physical work that is very necessary to life. And I think that is very important, because if cooking isn't hinged to necessity, it's just like a hobby or a photo op. And much as I like taking photos of everything I eat is there to make me, to sustain me, to make me feel strong. I hope to make me feel healthy as I go into, please God, old age. And I think all these things are important, because otherwise it loses its moorings a bit.
That was beautifully said. And I don't know, I cooked a lot out of this book in preparation for this interview, and it really was everything I made just felt like I was being taken care of. I mean, I cook out of cookbooks all the time, but there is something about the combination of ingredients and the way you write about them that really does come across.
I'm pleased.
Was really nice. So I have a lot of your questions. I think the ushers are going to collect more cards. If you think of something, you can write it down.
Okay, and I will try not to go on at such length, but I always do.
And I like that some of you signed your questions, which is nice. Okay, let's see. Why aren't you writing for the New York Times? I miss you.
I would ask the New York Times.
What is your best advice? What is your best advice for a novice cook?
I think the best advice for a novice cook, or anybody, which is to cook for yourself, because when you cook for yourself, you don't worry about something going wrong, so you don't have that stress. And I think it's that stress of thinking something will go wrong that puts people off cooking. Because, like, you know what? Most things in cooking can be rectified, errors. Oversalting, I don't think you can rectify oversalting.
What about that, the potatoes?
No, that potato doesn't work. They say it does. It might make a bit of difference.
Add more?
Sometimes you just, I mean, I loathe waste, but sometimes you just know nothing can be done. I mean, you can balance it out. It depends how egregious the error. So if, for example, sometimes some sugar will balance it, sometimes some acid, like some lime juice or lemon juice, will help. But if it's if the salinity is so high that it's off the scales, then nothing's going to help, really. I suppose keep it and use it as a brine. I think that's what I say. So you cook for yourself, and you need just think, oh yes, that's, you know, I shouldn't have put the heat up that high at that stage. That didn't work. Or no, those two spices don't go together. And I think the thing is that we live in a time when everyone is very, very obsessed with confidence. But I don't see how you can be confident until you're competent. And competence is not glamorous, but it's very necessary. And sometimes it's just being able to do something is important. And I think also I'd say, not just for people who are novice cooks, but for all of us who cook at home, is that just, we're not restaurant chefs. That's one of the reasons I went into this, is that we can't cook like restaurant chefs. I don't think it's desirable. That's why restaurants exist. And but I think that everyone tends to overreach themselves when they have people over. And then it becomes so stressful that it becomes like a performance art, you know, act. And I think that's not what it's meant to be like. When you go to other people's houses, you're not judging like that. You're thinking, how nice to be with my friends and what a great evening I've had. And so again, don't be so judgmental and harsh to yourself. But I do think cooking needs to be brought back to what it is, which is we're feeding ourselves and we're feeding other people, and that's very important. But I think it isn't. It doesn't sum up your worth as a person. It's not a moral force.
From Mark Rhodes, what makes a great host?
What makes a great host? I think you need to remember that you're there to make your friends and your guests feel welcome, and that has to be, if not uppermost in your mind, then the back of your mind. It has to underpin everything you do. And I think that really means, again, it goes back to not overstretching yourself, because if you're overstretched and tense, that tension will transmit itself to your friends. And we would all rather, we know very well that we'd rather sit round a table with even an over-salted gravy than with a really tense atmosphere. That is what really ruins any party.
That's a great answer. Linda Gordon asks, what would you serve on Downton Abbey?
What would I serve on Downton Abbey? Do you know, I don't know. I don't quite see myself as working in the kitchens there, Linda. but I'm always happy. I think I just make the tea. I can make a mean cup of tea. I'm a tea drinker, so I come with my own tea bags, I should add.
Oh. What is the first thing you learned to cook, and how old were you?
I can't remember exactly the first thing I learned to cook, because as I say, we were part of the larger enterprise at all times. But I must have been about 6 when I made mayonnaise. I would have thought, and my sister must have been 5, so I would have thought 5 and 6, 6 and 7, that sort of age, and I certainly think mayonnaise, but I do remember there were certain things I taught myself later, because we didn't eat dessert at home, because my father didn't go in for it, so we never had any, and which is why I suppose I quite liked doing baking later. It felt like a little detour from the role already assigned to me. But I did make some profiterole when I was quite young, and I saw a recipe somewhere someone told me how to make choux pastry, and that was quite fun. I remember doing that, and I suppose I must have been about 12.
And did you serve that to your family, or just
I think I served it to my mother, because although we didn't have desserts, she did have quite a sweet tooth. She did like it, but she had a very difficult relationship with food, my mother. And that's also, I think, why I don't go in for any of that, because I think I vowed I would not be that person. I would not be the person who would persecute myself around food or wouldn't allow myself to eat. It's important to me.
Yes.
It's hard to segue with these questions from the audience. The next question is, can you tell us about a kitchen fiasco?
Oh, I've had many kitchen fiascos. I was filming once and I set fire to a part of the kitchen. Luckily, the cameraman managed to do like that, get it while holding the camera. It's a handheld camera we film with. He managed to stomp it out without the director noticing at the time. I set fire to my own oven.
How did you set fire to your oven?
I don't know. I must have spilt some fat or something. And actually, it was when Salman Rushdie came for dinner, and it was during. And it was when he had bodyguards with him, and I had all these SAS men running into my kitchen. And then I looked like Lucille Ball, you know, I had my hair up, round bits here. But, you know, I managed to dust off a bit of the burnt bits off the lamb, and we carried on eating.
With a nice char.
Yeah, very fashionable now.
Yes. If you had us all over for dinner, what would you make us?
Something with chicken, I think. I want to go backtrack one moment to the kitchen fiascos. And it links to the thing about not having a tense atmosphere. I happened to have Yotam, among other people, for dinner not long ago. And I knew I had, I can't remember now whether I think I'd overcooked the potatoes or undercooked the potatoes or something like that. But I allowed myself to say it once, and this is my thing, don't apologize for something being wrong more than once, because after a while then it becomes difficult, so you have to, that's it, because we all do that, oh, this is wrong. You know, like people have gardens, they're gardeners, and you go to their house and their garden and they say, oh, you should have seen it last month. You know, it's always the wrong month for a gardener. And in the same way, I think very much is that we, you know, so yes, I've had fiascos, and I will sometimes say, look, I'm really sorry, this is not quite, you know, right, why this isn't wrong. But then, as I say, I do it just once, and I think that just let everyone enjoy themselves. What would I cook for you? Well, I'd quite like to cook for you a recipe that isn't in this book, but it's something that's very dear to my heart, which is, I call it my mother's praise chicken. And I say that because it's not quite braised and it's not quite poached. It's halfway between. It's sort of an act of devotion for us, her children, in her memory. And it's a very old-fashioned chicken in a pot with vegetables. And so it's sort of a bit like chicken soup, but not quite. It's like chicken in a pot. So you cook the whole chicken in it and then you start mixing. But we always, my mother always put a lot of lemon in hers. And also, a lot of dill at the end, and I have English mustard in mine, which I like English mustard a great deal, and I tend to get the turmeric in the English mustard, which makes it go bright yellow as well, because it's like a wonderful golden broth with vegetable leeks and carrots and chicken, and just good, plain, old-fashioned food and really delicious. But I might for dessert, there's a lot of desserts in there. The salted chocolate tart is sort of calling to me.
I think it's calling to us.
I feel you'd like it.
Yes, I think we would, too. Yeah. what is your best food memory? And you can just...
My best food memory? Well, I hate to think, it slightly panics me thinking of a good, like my best food memory as if all my eating is in the past. And I don't like that idea. I have so many good food memories. I mean, most recently I ate so wonderfully. I went to Thailand for the first time last Christmas, and a lot of the recipes here are inspired by that. So I suppose that is a good memory. I have a fantastic memory of a repeated memory, because I do it a lot, of whenever I come coming to San Francisco and having, you know, Judy Rogers' wonderful roast chicken with the bread in the Zuni Cafe. And I feel quite sad at going back since she passed, and I don't, you know, it's a great sadness, and that was a wonderful and hugely inspiring dish. And again, you know, that was, in a sense, you know, her food was so great because it was about taking inordinate trouble but always in the service of the food, not to bring applause and attention to the chef. And wonderful food writer and cook.
Yes, we all love. It was a very sad day for us here in San Francisco. Speaking about your trip to Thailand and the recipes that are inspired by that, can you tell us a little bit about the dish with the shrimp? I think someone and the noodles, the thin noodles that someone made for you.
There was a chef called Tum, like tummy, T-U-M, just the most perfect name for a chef. And he made a dish which I'd never eaten before, and which is always quite exciting, I think, you know, really different, which is you can do bean thread or rice noodles, which had a peppery star anise and also cinnamon in it with shrimp. And also using, you can probably get it here, but I can't get it that easy in London, Chinese celery, which is really all leaf, not much stem. So, but I can make an approximation by just using the little bits that come off the end of a stick of celery. But it was so extraordinary and so unlike anything else. And it sounds as if the cinnamon and noodles and shrimp would not go, but it is such a wonderful experience. And it retains the brightness of Thai cooking, but actually has a rather wonderful autumnal warmth enveloping it as well. It's not that bright heat that you get from from the chili, but certainly he used already ground pepper, which is what we at home would call school pepper. And I just did think, oh, this is amazing. I never thought I'd ever use school pepper in a recipe, and there I am. But it is extraordinary, and it's what's very nice for me is that people have started cooking the recipes and they, you know, put it on Twitter or Instagram and they hashtag the book I can see what recipes, and it's so nice when, you know, I take a food memory of my own and I give it there, and then other people cook it in their homes and it becomes part of your food memories and all your family's cooking. And I can't tell you what an honor that is for me, and how wonderful it feels for me to be able to share those moments, actually. And that's what makes doing what I do really, it's a very intimate thing and a very, for me, very important thing. That's why I like coming here and having a chance to meet you.
Thank you. What are your three recipes from this book that you would say we should make first?
Three recipes you should make first. This one, it's so difficult. Okay, I would definitely do the cauliflower, the roast spiced cauliflower and chickpea salad.
I definitely do that.
And what's nice, it's lovely warm out, first out. And it's really great. You can tell, you know, if you put it in a box and take it to work for lunch cold, it's great. I would do, I think, the chicken, and we call it a tray bake, chicken tray bake. I hastily ate a tartine gougère before I came in, and my tummy is going a bit. I would do the chicken tray bake with fennel and bitter orange, for sure. Now, if you want to try something which I'm really captivated by, I'm going to give you a choice here. You can I'm going to take in the dairy-free, gluten-free contingent, and you can do my apricot and almond cake with cardamom and rosewater, and it has pistachios on top, and that is wonderful. I mean, it's not using gluten-free flour or anything. It's or anything instead of that. It's actually a rather old-fashioned style of cake using almond meal, ground almonds, we call it, instead. And there's a bit of polenta, and it's got no fat, except it's got six eggs. It's a bit like my clementine cake and Claudia Roden's boiled orange cake. And I make that an awful lot. I think I made that and the matcha ice cream when Yotam came for supper. In fact, I can tell you what I made for myself.
Tell us.
But then also I'm going to have to say that there is an algo. There's also quite a fabulous vegan chocolate cake that I make because I have had a vegan over, and I now make it for all my family birthdays, and none of my family are vegan. So what did I make when he came? I made, I've got some Merguez meatballs. Mm-hmm. And I made those. He liked those. He did eat those.
And I just have to say, it's like a brilliant. It's not super hard. It's never occurred to me to take the sausage out of this casing and turn it into a meatball and like take all the glory.
Well, you see, the thing is, this laziness can be really inspiring. I had lots of different recipes. I did it all on the table. There were quite a few of us, and I wanted it to be like a mezze feel, so we weren't getting up and doing things. And so I did that cauliflower salad. I did the chickpea and sweet potato and caramelized garlic dip that I'd done at Thanksgiving last year. I did some roast squash with a green tahini dressing, which is really tahini and lots of mixed herbs. And I've got the meatballs. I'm trying to proceed the table now as I put it round me. Oh, and I did some lamb ribs. I did roast lamb ribs. And then I had matcha no churn ice cream and the apricot and almond cake for dessert.
That sounds wonderful.
It was nice. It was really relaxing. I mean, because it was all like really easy stuff and it could sort of sit around. It didn't have to be piping hot. The ribs did, but nothing else. So it wasn't like, oh my God, I've got to get all the timing at the same, everything's got to come at the same time. I think there was one other thing and I can't remember what it was now.
You can shout it as we...
Shout it.
Yes.
Well, I shout think it later.
We want to make sure we have plenty of time for all of you to have Nigella sign your book and buy a copy from Omnivore. And I want to thank you for coming, and I want to thank Nigella for being here.
Thank you. Thank you.